Okay, then let's continue. Maybe let's close the door now, because at one point people will wake up and also go to university on a Monday, and then we get louder. Thank you. Good. So what we've now actually already seen is that these epsilon i's, these error terms, are sampled from univariate Gaussian distributions. And what we intuitively also implied here is that they are independent in the following, oops, sorry, in the following sense. Greco implied already two things, namely that they're also identically distributed. So that's then the thing for this session, independent and identically distributed i's. So we already, like I said, we already implied that by what I've shown you previously, and now we just want to make it a little bit more formal, and also set up the corresponding math appropriately so that the notation gets relatively simple. So what we already, of course, had done when we sampled from here one of these probability distributions with probability density function given by the normal curve and with parameter 0 and sigma square, is that if we take a first sample and we get something like this, and then we take a second sample, we of course took it from, if you want, the same distribution. You can also think of another distribution with exactly the same parameters. Yeah? So that's more kind of a, it's not even a philosophical question, it's more like it's the same thing essentially. Yeah? But the important thing is that we took the first and the second and then also the third epsilon sample here. We took them from distributions, let's say three normal distributions with exactly the same parameters. Yeah? So that was always is always a distribution with expectation parameter 0 and variance parameter sigma square. And this variance parameter sigma square is the same for the first epsilon i, for the second epsilon i, and for the third epsilon i. Yeah, so that's is this thing that these epsilon i's are identically distributed. Yeah, so that's this. Just meaning that they have the same distribution. Yeah, and but we already did this, so this is not a surprise. The other thing is what we also implicitly did when we sampled now again is that we didn't think about when we take a next sample, what the samples before were. Yeah? So if I now take again a sample, it doesn't matter whether we already took these three samples which we have here. Oops. If I'm just taking another sample, it will come out somewhere. So mounting a sample that comes out here, and that's our epsilon 4. To make this clear, what dependency would mean is something like, for example, if your first sample, let's, oops, so if your first sample would be positive, if your first sample would be positive, so that you get something here, then because epsilon 1 is positive, that it's more likely for epsilon 2 to be also positive. And then if you sample something positive again, that again, it's more likely that you observe something positive. But we didn't, talk about this at all. And this would be a form of stochastic dependence, but we don't have that. Yeah. So don't don't get confused. We don't have that. We didn't discuss it. And what we just thought always like a fresh start, we take one sample here. And regardless of what that sample was, we then have a sample here. Regardless of what that sample was, we take a sample here. Overall, of course, we have more samples close to zero than in the towards the edges. Yeah. So that's the independent aspect. So there is no information that goes from one sample to the next, or there's no dependence of the ith sample on the I minus one sample. Yeah? So they are all, and that's what it then means, they are all independently sampled. So this independent and identical distribution is also often abbreviated with IID. Yeah? IID means independent and identical distributed errors. Questions about this? The way that I've now explained IID? No. Good, so that's fairly intuitive. Mathematically, it's more or less intuitive because sampling multiple random variables defines a joint distribution over them. So let's say we have three samples, then we would have three random variables that may take on values. And if we sample them, we essentially take a sample from a three-dimensional, if we have three random variables, three-dimensional probability distribution. And this idea of independent sampling corresponds in probabilistic terms to the fact that the probability or the probability density for the observation of a triplet of these here, of these random variables, is the same as the product of the probabilities for each one of the individual epsilons. Yeah? So again, this is discussed at some length in the mathematical preliminaries. So please look into that if you're not quite happy with this factorization property. The factorization property can nicely be also related to conditional probabilities and essentially conditional probabilities in the sense that if you have something, if you have two random variables being independent, then the conditional probability of X given Y is the same as the probability or the marginal probability of X. So Y, the knowledge of Y has no influence on the distribution of X. So if you're not quite happy with that stochastic independence is modeled by factorizing the probability distributions slash the probability density functions slash the probability mass functions, please look into it. It's in the mathematical preliminaries. You can also look at it in the statistics for data science, where we discussed that last week, I think, or the week before. That's now taken as a given, and we don't go into more detail there because I want to focus on another aspect of this independence, because what we now want is that our epsilon 1, 2, 3, and so on to epsilon n are independently sampled from univariate Gaussian distributions. Yeah? So think again, we have our y1, y2, y3, 2yn. They are given in our model by these mu values that we get from design matrix and parameters, and then there's the added random term. And now the idea is that epsilon 1 is sampled from a univariate Gaussian with mean expectation parameter 0 and variance parameter sigma square. Epsilon 2 is also sampled from a univariate Gaussian with expectation parameter 0, variance parameter sigma square, epsilon 3, and so on to epsilon n. Yeah. So this, what I just wrote down here, this basically just means that the epsilon I are IID sampled, well, they are just IID from n 0 sigma square. Yeah. Again, so from what I've all explained before, if you think about epsilon 3, this is distributed according to a univariate Gaussian with expectation 0 and variance parameter sigma square. In the specification of this distribution, there is no such thing as epsilon 2 or epsilon 1 or epsilon n. Yeah? So the distribution of epsilon 3 has nothing to do with what epsilon 2, what the value of epsilon 2 is, or the epsilon value of epsilon 1. Yeah, so in this sense, they are independent, and it's almost trivial to see that they're independent, because these distributions, there's nothing in these distributions that links the distribution of a certain epsilon I to any of the other epsilon I's. Now, what we want to specify, though, is a distribution now not only over each individual epsilon I, as we did here, but over the entire vector of epsilon i's. Yeah? So we want to, because we want to get to this matrix notation of the GLM, where things look like this, and this is a vector, this is a design matrix, parameter vector, and a random vector. We want to talk about the distribution of all the epsilons together, so the distribution of this random vector epsilon. And the first thing that I will now introduce is that we assume that this epsilon vector is distributed according to a multivariate normal distribution. And then in a second step, I will show you that if we set specific parameters for this multivariate normal distribution, then we reproduce the idea that these epsilon 1, 2, 3, up to n are IID sampled from univariate Gaussians. Yeah? So let's first now take a step back and just discuss the multivariate Gaussian distribution. So a multivariate Gaussian is the distribution of a vector, and let's call this vector x. So we're now talking about an n-dimensional thing, and this n-dimensional thing has a probability density function associated with it, which is the multivariate normal density, and this takes in general the following mathematical form. So now you just need to just be aware of, although it looks fairly similar to the univariate case, now we're talking about an x that is n-dimensional, a mu that is n-dimensional, and a sigma that is a matrix. It's an n times n matrix, which is positive definite, which you can see an analogy to the variance parameter of a univariate Gaussian being positive. In the mathematical preliminaries, there's more on the positive definiteness, meaning it also means that it's actually symmetric, so the transpose of sigma equals sigma. Now, the probability density function for a multivariate normal distribution is fairly similar to that of a univariate Gaussian. Is anyone willing to specify the multivariate probability density function from the mathematical preliminaries? No? The formula, yeah. You've written it down. Okay, I also written it down. It's fairly similar to the univariate. So if you want to memorize, and I think it's actually an exam question, so you should memorize this. If you memorize the multivariate Gaussian form, always think about the univariate form, which you, of course, are familiar with. So it starts, or it has, again, this 2 pi factor. If this thing is n-dimensional, then you actually have n times this factor. You have the square root, and it's 1 over, so you have to the power of minus n half. Then you also have in this normalization factor division by the variance, which in the multivariate case corresponds to, or division by the square root of the variance, which corresponds to, in this case, the determinant of the covariance matrix to the power of minus 1/2, which is, of course, 1 over the square root of the determinant, and the determinant here as a kind of single value for the width or the space that the covariance matrix spans. So if you're not happy with what the determinant is, again, mathematical preliminaries discusses that. So, but this is, so just to see the analogy, what I'm just wrote here is the square root is the to the power of 1/2, the 1 over is the minus, and then you have here the 2 pi, and you have the sigma square. The sigma square is here the determinant of sigma, and the 2 pi is still there, and you have this 2 pi factor n times. So that's one way to remember it. That's the normalization factor, and then you have the exponential term, which of course you also, we also have here, so where it was 1/2 sigma square x minus mu square. Now, of course, our x and our mu are vectors, so a square in terms of vectors corresponds to taking the difference between these vectors, transposing the first one and multiplying it with the difference again. So that's kind of the square aspect here. We have the minus 1/2, and what we also need is a division by the variance, which for the multivariate Gaussian comes down to sandwich multiplicating the inverse of the covariance matrix in here. Yeah, so this here, that's the probability density function for n-dimensional Gaussian distribution. It looks like that. So in the mathematical preliminaries, you find a fairly detailed example for the case that n equals 2, so a 2-dimensional Gaussian. And if you there plot this probability density function, then you will, if you look at the isocontours, so where there's the same kind of probability density, you would, for example, see something like this, where you here would have the x1, the x2, and this whole thing is talking about, of course, a 2-dimensional scenario. So we're talking about the probability density that is allocated to each pair of values, x1 and x2. Of course, the whole thing is still centered on the expectation parameter, which is here a 2-dimensional thing. This is also very important. The multivariate Gaussian, regardless of how many dimensions you have, is always unimodal. Yeah, it always has a peak at the location of the expectation vector. Only because there are more dimension doesn't mean it suddenly gets multiple peaks or something. It's always centered, has the highest probability density at the location of the expectation vector. And then how it actually looks in terms of here, if you want a positive correlation, that then really depends on what is in the covariance matrix. So essentially there, for the 2-dimensional scenario, there are the cases that you have positive covariance between the 2 coordinates. That would be that the off-diagonal elements in the covariance matrix here So the covariance matrix, of course, would look like this. With a square or without square, it doesn't really matter. It's just notation. But this would be that this would mean that these values here are positive if you have the case of something like this. Then these off-diagonal elements here would be negative. And then, of course, the case that we are most interested in is the case that the covariance parameters between the two or more variables are all zero, so that there is no covariance. Then you would have this circular-shaped thing. Now it looks like a mess, but this is discussed in a lot of detail in the mathematical preliminaries on Gaussians, so have a look there to get an intuitive feeling about the two-dimensional case. Two-dimensional case is nice and good to learn about. We usually have more than two data points, so we have to think about n-dimensional, so 3, 4, 5, 10, or if you do fMRI, like 400-dimensional Gaussian distributions, and this cannot really be visualized. There is not much one can do in terms of visualization. But what is now important is that we can formulate a multivariate Gaussian distribution over our epsilons that corresponds to the idea that the epsilon i's are independently and identically distributed according to univariate Gaussians. Yeah? So the univariate independent and identically sampling we have a good intuition about, and this is what we discussed here. Now we can construct a multivariate Gaussian that, if we take a sample from this multivariate Gaussian, the distributions of these epsilon i's, all of them, are the same as if we would sample them this way. Another way you can see that or think about it is in terms of taking samples on a computer. Yeah. So if you want to take a sample from a GLM, you might sample these epsilon values for each data point and hence draw them from a univariate Gaussian, and you would need a for loop or something to do this repeatedly. The other way you can do this is to sample one value from an n-dimensional Gaussian, which of course then corresponds to a vector of n epsilon values, but you need to specify the parameters of this multivariate Gaussian accordingly. Yeah, and this is now what I would like to show you. So this is something that is also in the mathematical preliminaries under independent Gaussian distributions. So and I just see that there's actually a typo in this thing. So the point here is that what we want is that our epsilon I, so epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon 2n, have a distribution that factorizes into the individual distributions of these epsilon n. Yeah? So what this means is here you specify a probability density over n values. If you take a sample, what you essentially get is a vector of n values. And this just means to compute the probability or the probability density for a set of n values, you just multiply the probability for each of the individual values. Now the probability for the individual values we had already specified in terms of univariate Gaussians. Yeah? So we said the probability distribution of epsilon 1 is a univariate Gaussian with expectation 0 and variance sigma square, and the same thing for epsilon 2 and so on for Little Epsilon N. Now, so this just means here IID from univariate Gaussians. Now, is that clear? Do you have questions about this? Actually, I see a lot of you writing. You don't have to write any of this because this is all in the script. If it helps you to write, write it. But if you are trying, if you're not kind of being able to follow me talking because you have to write so much, then don't write, because it's really all in the script. So there's nothing that in terms of your notes you would really, really need. Maybe it helps you to write it down. I can appreciate that, but yeah, it's actually, you might more focus on the explanations than writing up things up. Anyway, so questions about this right now? No. Good. So what we're trying to specify is this joint distribution over the n epsilons, and we are as far as saying, okay, they are given in terms of probability density functions, univariate ones for each of the epsilons. And of course, we know the functional form of these. So if we want to compute the probability density for all of them, well, what we need to do is to now fill in our, epsilon 1 minus 0 square. So we can also just, because the expectation parameter is always 0, we don't have to write it up at all. So we can just put epsilon 1 square, then we have to write less. And the next one, and so on. So I don't want to write it again and again. But this is what is behind saying, okay, the epsilon 1, 2, and so on are all independently distributed according to univariate Gaussians. So this can, of course, also be expressed using the product sign, which just summarizes this as in this way. Now, so this just says multiply n times this expression here, and then you have the probability density for the joint. And this can also, again, I'm switching a little bit between writing things explicitly and more implicitly. So more implicitly, of course, this can also be written like this. Yeah. So this is all about IID with univariate Gaussians. The bottom line is you just multiply the probability density functions for all the univariate Gaussian variables, and then by multiplying that you get an expression for the probability density of the joint observations of the epsilon I. And yeah, so this is just what IID sampling means in terms of the probability density of the individual ones. Now we want to relate this to the multivariate normal distribution. Yeah?
And in terms of our experiment, we have the epsilon or the independent variables.
No, it's the no. it's wrong in actually two kind of settings. So first of all, it's
Now it's not, maybe it's only wrong in one way. So everything about the independent variable is in the excess. Yeah? The epsilon is a noise contribution.
So still the noise.
Yeah. So we are only talking about the noise right now.
Okay, but is the noise, but the noise is also related now, like we have more observed epsilon 1, 2, and E. Is this always related to another independent variable or just to another data point?
Now, epsilon 1 refers to data point y1, epsilon 2 to data point y2. So that's,
okay.
It's actually like here, so nothing has changed.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they have only one independent variable and then it's only the different data points, the epsilon 1 and 2. Because you can also have more than one independent variable.
So independent variable, so don't get confused between the notion of independent and dependent variables and random variables. Yeah. So with independent variables, I just mean the axis. That's the design. With dependent variables, I mean the y's, which is what is observed. And the epsilons are neither independent or dependent variables. They are just the noise contributions to the deterministic aspect, which corresponds to the independent variable.
Right, so my question is more like each noise, like epsilon 1, 2, m, refers to the data point.
Yeah.
And in each linear regression, we have only one noise, right? So, okay, we will continue with this.
Yeah, I'm not very clear what the question is.
That's when you have more independent variables, right?
When we say independent variables, let's say independent experimental variables or independent random variables. So what do you mean?
The design, not
the design.
Random.
Okay, the experimental variables.
Experimental, and I mean each experimental variable can have different noises as well.
No. This is what we will see later, but if you think about, but here you have two, if you want, in this case, two independent experimental variables, one being x that takes on the values 1, 1, 1,
mm-hmm.
and a second one which takes on the values 1, 2, 3.
Mm-hmm.
We will see, of course, much, much bigger design matrices where you have many more independent experimental variables. But for each data point, there's only one noise term associated with a data point.
Okay, yeah.
Good. Well, it's good. We need to clarify these things. So, but now to finalize this, so what we now discuss so far only is the IID univariate Gaussian case, and now I finally want to make the point about the parameters of a multivariate Gaussian that can reproduce exactly this. And the bottom line and the most important thing that you always need to keep in mind for all of this is that the epsilon vector, so epsilon being now n-dimensional, is distributed according to a multivariate Gaussian with an expectation vector of n zeros and a covariance matrix corresponding to the identity matrix multiplied with one variance parameter, which I also refer to as a spherical covariance. And we have to speed up a minute. So we are now talking about sampling an n-dimensional epsilon vector from this multivariate Gaussian. And what I'm claiming is that if we sample n-dimensional epsilon vector from a multivariate Gaussian with expectation vector of all zeros, so that's n zeros, one above another, and with a spherical covariance matrix parameter, that means that on the diagonal we have a sigma square and everywhere else we have zeros, then this corresponds to independent and identically sampling from n Gaussians univariate Gaussians with expectation parameter zero, just a scalar, and variance parameter sigma square. And this is actually fairly easy to show. So that's in the independent Gaussian distributions in the mathematical preliminaries. So the way to see that is just to actually write things out. So yeah, I'm doing it there more generally, with mu not necessarily being zero. And let's do. Well, it's fine. We do it with the with mu being all zeros. So zero n sigma square pi n. Now, what does that mean? Well, we have seen our multivariate Gaussian probability density function. So this is just, if we write it out, and here we have, now we can also write this as epsilon minus 0n, and then we have the inverse of sigma square in, then we need a transpose, and we have epsilon minus 0n. So this is just the multivariate Gaussian probability density function for the parameters of an expectation vector of all zeros and a spherical covariance matrix, so sigma squared times the identity matrix. Now, we can of course write that out more explicitly. So the first thing here is that we have to the power of minus n half. So that means that we actually have n times this expression. So we have n times 2 pi to the power of minus 1 half. We have the determinant of a diagonal matrix. So if you, this is also in the mathematical preliminaries, the determinant of a diagonal matrix is just the product of the diagonal entries, and the diagonal entries are always sigma square, and that, so you have to multiply n times sigma square, so that corresponds to sigma square to the power of minus n half, if one is fairly explicit. And then here we have the inverse of a diagonal matrix, and sigma square being non-zero. So the inverse of this diagonal matrix is just 1 over sigma square, and if you then do the matrix multiplication with this inverse matrix, you need to multiply each of these entries in the in this vector by 1 over sigma square, and you can take that out of this, so you get the 1 minus the 1 over sigma square out of this expression, and here you get and here remains this vector product. Yeah? So if you're not quite happy with that, look again into the matrix algebra stuff. It's actually fairly straightforward if you write it out even more explicitly. So here we have again a product of n terms. So we can also put this into this expression to the power of minus 1 half. Here we also have to the power of minus 1 half. To the power of 1 half is square root. Minus means 1 over, so we have 1 over 2 pi sigma square. And now if we write out our vector product here more, this means of course that we transpose this column vector and multiply each of these entries with each of the entries of the second column vector, and then we square them, we multiply them, that means we square them because it's the same thing, and then we add them all up. So if you just write it out in terms of the rules of matrix multiplication, you get this. Actually, this zero, yeah. Now let's call it, and it's more sensible to call this zero. So this zero is now the scalar zero. The zero n was always the n-dimensional vector. So this is just what I'm just wrote here is just what this here means. And then we have a sum inside an exponential. And if you look into the mathematical preliminaries, then you will see that if you have a sum inside an exponential, you can rewrite this as a product of exponentials that have the individual terms of the sum as input arguments. So essentially what this corresponds to is that x a b no sorry x x equals x a plus b, which just is basic potentiation, taking powers. So now doing this the other way around, starting from a sum, we get a product. So we have a product of these terms. And then we have these two product signs, and we end up that we can also multiply them individually and not first all of those and then all of those. So we get to this. Oops, there's an X missing. And this is, of course, the product of n univariate Gaussian densities with expectation parameter zero and variance parameter sigma square. Yeah. So this is what we already discussed here. Yeah. So this is this little proof 518 in the mathematical preliminaries. There's a typo in the last line because there's a product sign missing. So what's the point of all of this? The point is we want to model independent and identical sampling from univariate Gaussians. Yeah, this is how we define these error or noise contributions. We can either sample each of them individually from a univariate Gaussian, or we can take a sample of n such values from a multivariate Gaussian for which we set the parameters to a vector of all zeros and a spherical covariance matrix. The probability densities that these two scenarios give us, so this scenario and this scenario here, are identical. Yeah, that's because they have the same probability density functions, they correspond to the same distribution. And this is the way we want to talk about now the GLM in the future, where we say that y plus epsilon, where the epsilon is distributed according to a multivariate Gaussian with the spherical covariance matrix. Yeah, think about it, and I didn't record anything. Shit. I recorded. Sorry. Think about it, and remember your questions, and please ask me your questions next time, because I now need to run to the next lecture.